All right, I'm happy to see you all this afternoon, and I promise you this will be an awesome talk. I hope you learn something about IT architecture and what has it to do with freedom and free and open source tools, of course. And I'm going to talk about open architecture. So let's get started. Because there's a lot of things to talk about. And of course, a bit of fun. Don't hesitate to raise your arm if you think, I missed something. Can you explain it a bit deeper or in another way? So let's make this interactive. Look at this picture. Who recognized this picture? Yeah, you're from the forum. You're my age, a bit.
Windows.
Yeah, so we're seeing an elevator. Maybe there's software in, we know there's software in. Yeah, should we trust it? What was the design? Is the software designed to, make people jump in the elevator to move them from one floor to another? Was this software borrowed, to move rocks from one floor to another? Does it matter? What are the requirements? So there's a lot of things you can see. This little girl, maybe she was afraid to go in that thing because, maybe it didn't work well. Now, the people who know this picture, people who saw this movie, it was a famous Dutch movie. A lot of people didn't go to the elevators a few weeks. So, who am I?
The elevator.
The lift in Dutch, of course. So we're talking about architecture, freedom, and open architecture. And who am I, of course? Because you know, who is that guy? My name is Michael. Just, as you pronounce in Dutch. I do mainly IT architecture and design. I love creating good architectures, and what architecture is, we come right to it. I'm, as it's called, a certified architect. You have to go to that awesome book. We talk about that later. And I'm not quite Linux. I'm more a BSD guy, but of course I love GPL things. We all love freedom, of course. So we are talking about, what is it? We all have our view. What is IT architecture? So I will give you a crash course, and you can say, all right, you can go to multiple courses, but I will teach you within 10 minutes, I promise you, we all know what it is and what it isn't. Then we dive into architecture frameworks and methods. It's a spooky field, but you have to hear some things and then you know it. You can use it in your daily work. And then we're going to, open architecture. And why do we need it? This is TDOS. This is all about freedom, free and open source. So there is something to say about that. And maybe the people who are familiar with IT architecture and digital architectures, there is something with the open group architecture framework, Archimate. This is recorded, so I'm going to say some words about that. So let's get started. What is it? Raise your hands. Who has a view on IT architecture? All right. Do you want to share it with us?
Sure. So the first question is, what is architecture, right?
Yeah.
So I think it's like the components and the relationships between the components of a system, a sort of definition of architecture that I try to make. And then you apply it to IT, and IT is information technology, so the architecture of information technology. So the components and how they fit together of an information system, for example.
All right. Thank you very much. There are a lot of words. So I say, is it that complex? Let's make it a bit easier for all of us to understand. Because, architecture lingo, words that not everybody can Yeah, maybe some persons were lost after three sentences. We all have a view about what it is. We are software people, engineers. That's good. So, if you look at a picture like this, is this IT architecture? Yeah, why not? You see a CPU, maybe. You see a picture, some lines. You can call this IT architecture. Why not? All right. Nobody has to agree. Another view, a picture. All right. What is it? Is this IT architecture? Sorry?
Yes, it becomes in Blender 3D. Everything has fetishes and the.
This has nothing to do with Blender. So this is also a view on architecture, as I call it. There's something with quality, monies maybe, people. This is also a view. With IT architecture or digital architecture, whatever you call it, there are many, many definitions, maybe too many. And it's very easy to get lost, that you get discussion, what is it, what is it not? So be aware. If you ask the question to somebody, you get an opinionated answer. Now that's good, because we all love opinions. Then we can argue and discuss. Yeah, but that's more software architecture. No, that's more business architecture. No, that's information architecture. That's good. So we all have our views. And if you look at definitions, you see this kind of awesome lines of text. This was abbreviated. Of course, you don't read it, because when you try to read it, you get completely lost. It's relations, things that structured, and is, I say, if that's hard, maybe the definition is not that good, and nobody agrees. So some simple guidelines, very simple to remember. Architecture must have a purpose. Compare it to the architecture of the elevator. It has a purpose, transport things. Architecture should also, in our digital view, have a purpose. And of course, it needs to have describe some fundamentals. So keep that in mind. So it has some properties that you should agree on all. Another picture, because you know architects love pictures and love drawing. From an enterprise point of view, you have business. How is my organization working? We call that, business. There's data, there's applications. You can call it, is this architecture? Yeah, you can argue, is this architecture? No, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. There is no one who says, I have the one definition and it's, endorsed by the United States or Trump, whatever you, the one you believe. So, to summarize, architecture is, don't fall in the trap into, oh my God, the definition discussion. It's useless, painless. It's about what. And it's a bit about how. Not everything about how, because that is more technical design, software engineering. Not everything about what, because then you are describing all processes, activities, data flows. No, IT architecture, digital words, is the combination between what and how. And try to keep away from the why. I know it's Sunday. So, why questions are very good, but yeah, you only lose time. So, frameworks and architecture. As said before, architects are, not always the most good programmers. Most of the time, they were very bad programmers. They love technology, but they have no clue what it is. So they try to model the world and take pictures, make drawings, and love selfies. Does anybody know this picture? Look, seriously? Yeah, it was a famous picture. And why was it such a famous picture? Because the monkey took itself, and there were a lot of legal things year after year, and it turns out the monkey has the rights of this picture. Keep that in mind, because it is important when we are going to talk about freedom and sharing things. Architects, of course, love selfies too, but are very keen on methods and frameworks. So a difficult part. There are a lot of frameworks, and there are a lot of methods. And now comes my promise to you. If you know one principle about frameworks and methods, do you know them all? Raise your hands. Do you think if you know one, do you know them all? Yeah, I see some hesitation, maybe. Yeah. So, if you know the core of what a framework or method is, it's easier to dive into other architecture frameworks and methods. So let me explain what I mean. There is a clear distinction between methods and frameworks. It is not always clear if somebody is talking about a method. This is the way we design our systems, step by step, and yeah, maybe they're using tools or yeah, some structure in it. And is that the framework, or is it yeah, the other way around? So make sure that if people are talking about methods and frameworks, to ask, what do you mean? Is that a method or is it a framework? And keep in mind that a methodology is how people think, what you do. And a framework, yeah, you can use it, yeah, it's supposed to be. You can have different frameworks for the same methodology. So keep this in mind, because I hope you are going to read or do more with IT architecture when creating new software things. And sooner or later, these kind of things pop up. So continue. What is it all about, those kind of methods and frameworks? So very simple. There's always a what question. What should be built from a business point of view, from an information point of view, from a data point of view? There's always the how. Now, that's most of the time a logical explanation. And then, with what do we build it? In Java, Golang, PHP, Perl, whatever. And of course, you can argue again about why, but make sure to keep it away from your architecture, because you lose only time. So, the layers with what, how, and with what apply to the business pillar, information pillar, and your information or data pillar, and your technology stack. If you keep this picture in mind, and I will put the slides on the Tido site, of course, with this simple picture, you can capture all architecture, methods, and methodologies, whatever is around. Because in essence, they are always talking about these four pillars. Sometimes it's called differently. They have more layers besides these three. But in essence, this is what all architecture methods and frameworks are about. So then you see again the lingo. Oh, I do architecture. Yeah, business architecture. Yeah, I'm keen on data. Oh, I call myself data architect. And with this kind of picture, you can point out, all right, what's the area you're doing? Are you programming? Are you software creating software? Are you infrastructure architect? So you have a better understanding about what is your daily job? What do you deliver? What are you delivering with what? And in large companies, you see a lot of people for every area that you can think of from this picture. In small area, it's all one person. or in small companies, it's all one person. So what do we have out in the open? There is that famous US department, we call it WARS, but they have also a great IT infrastructure behind it because they have now drones and other things. And why is it famous? Because you wouldn't expect it, but it's very open. You can read their IT architecture, business-like, what data are they using, how are they using it. Another one is from Sogeti, that's more a dynamic code architecture. The famous one we come later is the Open Group architecture framework. These are the most famous frameworks around in this world. In essence, it falls back. And let me show you this one again. All those frameworks fall back on this simple division. So keep this in mind. And when you are going to dive into the famous books and this method, make it simple again for yourself. Don't fall in the trap of architecture lingo. So, what do architects deliver? Because when I create software, I'm delivering, non-working code, sometimes some working code, whatever. But architects, what are they paid for? What do they deliver? Because there is a vision, we need software for our new business, startup, or our current business, and in the end, we have working software and people using that software through internet. That's some people call that startup, whatever. So what do architects deliver? In essence, you create maybe some principles, requirements, you make some models, you draw it on a whiteboard, you take a picture of your drawing. Like the architects in the construction world who draw your new house, and then you say, build it, and suddenly your house but it doesn't look like the drawing again. That's of course also with IT most of the time, but you document things. So in essence, what architects do is what in the circle. In large companies, you have requirements engineers and all those other people, but the end product is always to make sure the things can be realized, partly in software, maybe partly in new organization parts, whatever. But that's the key purpose of architecture, make sure you get delivered what is needed. So think about that elevator again. You have an assignment for an elevator. So the first question is, should it carry rocks, dead rocks, or little children? And should they be able to use the elevator by themselves, that they press the buttons or not? And that are requirements, principles, should it be safe? If something, maybe if the power is off, what should happen? Now that should be the work of the architects. And why do we need open architectures? And what is it, open architectures? Because I hope we all now have some understanding of what architecture is, why it is important, and why you should need it, and we need it, and we use it in our daily work. Open. And asking the why question to Richard, what kind of answer do we get? It's for freedom people, like I hope also people I see here, of course it should be open, no question about it. We need to share, it should be open. So asking this why question, but I do formulate the why question because a lot of people working in the IT industry are not familiar with open source and are not familiar with open standards and are certainly not familiar with open architectures, whatever that may be. So let's dive into open architectures. Sorry for the why question. Let's skip this. So open architecture, it should be about sharing our thoughts together. I work in one company, you work in another company. If we share that, yeah, maybe we all benefit. It's an open source thing. Creating things, principles, reusing. If you do it only for your own company, only for your own elevator company, yeah, why do that? The same goes for reuse. Why don't we reuse the methods? Why do we have so much methods and frameworks? It's insane, of course. Now the bad news. There is, of course, the same as with architectures. There are a lot of people who say, I know what an open architecture is because I work at IBM or Oracle or Microsoft. And if you use my famous product, yeah, you get an open architecture because it's based on open standard. You can easily adjust it. It's very flexible. And oh yeah, what's the latest buzzword? Microservices, RESTful, yeah. Whatever you want to is the latest term. They offer it as an open architecture, and we believe it. Many people believe that's what open architecture is all about. So you can, for instance, take this picture in mind. You have a house, and you can say, "Oh, right, in my house, I want another table," and it's very easy to switch a table. Or in my house, I have a very nice wife, but I want another wife. So you can easily switch your wife in your house, whatever. But this main perception, people, is wrong. In reality, this is what open architectures end up. It's not very easy to adjust or extend or whatever. All those promises are, yeah, at best, a lie people didn't realize. So they are wrong. Reset your mind about open architecture. Whenever you hear the coming weeks, the rest of this year, people talking about open architecture, argue with them. How open is it? Because, for instance, if you have a content management system, a very good one with a very nice front end, and you see another even better, and that one has maybe a better back end, and you say, "Oh, I take the front end of the one, the back end of the other," do you then have the perfect content management system? No, of course not. It's not that easy. Those architectures are not that open. So, a new view on maybe what we should collaborate on. What is then open architecture? In my opinion, and that's why we should argue about it, for instance, maybe it should be based on an open process that everyone in a company, yeah, can give input. Because when I work as an engineer somewhere, yeah, I get thrown on my desk, program this. Yeah, is that open, an open process? No. And if I think, maybe I want to collaborate with people in another company, is that possible? No. So you need an open process. Maybe think about it. It's difficult. Another thing is, all right, tools. Maybe to create your architecture, you need to create documentation, principles. Maybe you need some tools, open tools. And if you publish your architecture, most people use those famous Microsoft Office products still, or other proprietary things. Maybe you should think about publishing it under a common creative license. Who knows what this kind of license is? Raise your hands. That's not enough, I think. Yeah. It's the license that's also used for Wikipedia. So everyone can use or reuse your ideas, your thoughts, whatever you have written. And of course, there is some pain with it, especially when you're working in companies who only have one purpose: making sure you make more money with less people. So think about it. And of course, there should be with something with, I call it standards, because there is a lot of things to do about how open is a suited standard be. Because I always say a standard is worthless, even if it is an open standard, if I cannot implement and make an implementation within 2 days or 3 days. Everyone ever seen one of those standards for for instance, data sharing using the SOAP protocol 2.1. Yeah, you're screwed. You know it. It's not that open because it's not hitting the wire level. Everyone can make his own implementation. In the next room, there's now some presentation about the open document format. A silly format. Open, yeah, but everybody makes his own mistake. So think about it again. Do we have already open architectures? Yeah, there are some really large FOSS projects who have managed to write down what their key principles are, what their key requirements are, what data is in their systems, what data is of you, how security works. So there are some of these examples. There are some companies, not a few, but I see more and more companies who also publish their business architecture out in the open. The best news for us as, yeah, I hope we all pay a lot of tax, because I like people who pay a lot of tax, then we all are very wealthy. Governance, more and more publish their architectures. And that's good, because then we know how the governance are processing what they know, what they do with our data, our money, whatever. And the governance also does some things with software. So it's very good to read how they are doing it. And yeah, this is worldwide, people. Mainly also in UK and Australia, open governance movements. So free and open source tools for your open architecture. Because when you are creating architectures, yeah, why use tools? You can write everything in VI or Emacs, but in the end you want to share things in an easy way, maybe make some models. Architects and designers like to create some drawings. There are some modeling languages. And what tools are there? So let me introduce you to some tools. But before I do that, look at the colors. From an organization point of view, business, yeah, you can make many, many mistakes. And what I also see, there are not a large or many tools for your business architecture available. We at this conference are mainly interested in software, software tools, software to help better software. So the web part, yeah, there is a lot FOSS in that area. So we all know UML tools, requirement management tools, software compiler tools, those kind of things. We all heard about it. That's what FOSS is all about. But in the end, there is a very large gap, because the things that really matter is how that software is used in processes, by governance, in systems, how you model it, those kind of things. And we should have open tools for that also. Why not? Why use proprietary tools? And there are famous proprietary tools, they cost thousands and thousands of dollars. I think $6,000 per end user license to use enterprise architecture modeling software. And I'm not lying here. I've used that software. We've all heard from model-driven architecture software. Who has ever used model-driven architecture software? No? Oh, one minute. It's the dream of every engineer and architects. You create your model, and then the software creates a working system for you. So you only draw what you want to happen, and then you press the magic button, and everything is generated without errors. And people are trying that already for 30 years. The companies are, of course, not here, because they are not open source companies who claim they have managed to get it working on large scales. But don't believe those guys always. But it's good to know about it. So what tools do we really need for creating open architectures? We like drawings. So we have drawing software. That's the easy thing. Modeling tools. Yeah. If you want to create a model on how your software will working, who is using it, maybe you should create a model and need some modeling software. There is famous open source modeling software for creating chip layouts. Is there famous software for, is there free and open source software for creating IT models, business-wise, information-wise? Yes, I will show it. Documentation tools we need. Yeah, there is something available. A lot in the open source world. Is it perfect? No, not yet. Maybe we need more. Maybe we need to create it ourselves. That's what we're here for. We can create things. We are creators. So let me first show this one. This tool is free and open. This is a famous tool created to make Archimate diagrams. And Archimate is one of the things that you can use to create software architecture or business architecture or information architecture or all together. This tool is created free in the open, GPL. You can use it. So you can also buy this software, not this one, because this is really non-buyable, only usable for free. But there are, for instance, IBM, Oracle also deliver this kind of software, and then you pay a lot of dollars for it. This kind of software is also free and open source. Architects like modeling, business process models are such a thing, and there is also open source software for that. So take your advantage of knowing that these kind of free tools are there, have been created, and are being used on large scale. Who of you has ever created an ontology? Yeah. If you ever are working, for instance, with, let's call it an enterprise service bus or those kind of things, sooner or later, maybe you need to create a really very, very large model. Maybe if you're working on software for healthcare, you need to create a very good and decent structure for all your definitions. This software, and dive into it, is needed if you are creating very large systems that need to work on a very large scale without errors. Because nobody likes errors. And sooner or later you find out, this piece of software is free in the open to be used. You can use commercial packages also, but not of this one, because those commercial vendors never tell there is a very good open source variant. And this one is developed at the Stanford University. It's used by everyone who is creating serious ontologies, space companies, governance, whatever. It's not used at large in this country. So take a look at it. This one is also, do I have Java fans in the room? No? No, I'm no Java fan either, but if you only want to use Eclipse things, there is this famous tool around that you can use to create every model ever created, or model language. This tool can you can be used to create models of every model language ever standardized. And I think there are more than 40 model languages standardized within various organizations, standardized bodies. And this tool has captured them all. And you can use this tool to draw whatever diagram is needed for a company or a purpose, whatever. So know this tool is around. It's very good to know, even if you are not a Java fan. So there are many more of these kind of tools. I created a book, e-book, of course, Creative Commons license, where you can see more of these kind of tools. If you say, I use a tool, put it, give me a pull request so I can edit or fork it and make your own book. Before I dive in to closing this session, the Open Group. Who has ever heard of the Open Group? Oh, that's not too many people. When I now say, it talks like a duck, it sings like a duck, it looks like a duck, what do you all say?
It's probably a duck.
Yeah, then it's, maybe it's, it looks like Unix, because the open group has a trademark on Unix. So you may never call your operating system Unix, because they will sue you. Yeah, don't ask how they got the trademark rights and all the things. The open group has a long history with collecting all kinds of things. They have done good things, especially also in the architecture field, because if you're talking about IT architecture, we found all of every architect around the world has heard or read TOGAF, and TOGAF is the TOGAF stands for the Open Group Architecture Framework. And wherever you come, Brazil, Spain, Japan, people have heard of that architecture framework. And it's just a simple picture I showed you earlier. Of course, they have a book with 1500 pages and you can get a certification, whatever you want to do. But if you ever want to apply for a job as IT architect and you say, yeah, I know TOGAF, all right, bonus point. That's how easy it is. And they do a lot of good work. Also, Argumate is developed within the Netherlands. It's a modeling language for describing your business information, application, software, and infrastructure architecture. You can do everything. Most people who create modeling language come from university where people think, programming, yeah, but I don't make enough money, so I create a model language, and some people create Argumate. It's a very nice modeling language. You can do everything, but yeah, there is a but with TOGAF and Argumate. So a few nice words about this thing. They are good, you can use it, but there is a but. And then we think, what would Richard Stallman say? It looks like a duck. And he will say, yeah, it's malware people created by thieves, because the companies that are around the open group are IBM, Oracle, Microsoft, Capgemini, all those famous companies who steal our work, never contribute back, and yeah, they piss on open source. And we want to use the Open Group Architecture Framework and Argumate. And they say it's open because you can read it on the internet. Think again. Because it's trademark, it's license work. If you create a tool, you have to get a license and those kind of silly things. So in the end, it's not false. So that's the only thing you have to remember. It's not false. Period. So when I say, do we still have some challenges for getting to real open architectures? Yeah, of course, we need FOSS, we need you, we need the spirit of freedom. We need open data, yeah, that's hard, open data. We need open security, and I see people thinking, I was here last year, open security, yeah, but my company is very special, I cannot put how security works in a document. Oh, of course, not your secrets, not your passwords. But if you can read how that elevator works and what is happening when the power is off, maybe it's get a bit safer that people say, oh, you forgot there something in your design. So think about again, open access. Open access, use a license that everybody can say, all right, I use your work from your company, and I make it for my own company and make it better. I always say, suppose, and there will be a cure for whatever disease, cancer, whatever. And then I say, yeah, suppose it's trademark and licensed. And only people with a lot of money can use that medicine. Do we want it? No, of course not. And the same is happening with progress. We want to put people on whatever planet we want. We need progress. So get rid of those intellectual property things like trademarks, copyrights, and all those things. Go to open architectures. And of course there are challenges, yeah, but we can overcome it. We should overcome it. And it's a complex area, architecture, because it's the fuzzy thing, business. It's not a bit that is right or wrong. No, it's fuzzy. the devil with architecture, it's in the details sometimes. Yeah, I said, yeah, it's a bit about what and a bit about how. But sometimes details really matter. Think about that elevator. Some details really matter. Yeah. Also, people matter with open architecture. Because in the end, we make things working together. As closure, we all know this car. It's not out in the street yet. But suppose it is. Maybe, think about it. Do you want to read how it works? Do you want to see the software? Do you want to read the design principles? What should it do when people are going in front? Maybe yes, maybe no, but think about it. And if you say, maybe I don't care, and then think again. I want to thank you all for your attention. You can read more on this GitHub repo with a lot more stuff and a lot of more tools. Any questions? Discussion points? Somebody not yet knowing what an architecture framework or method is? All right, thank you, people.